It's time and we already have a quorum. Let's get the meeting started. We welcome the representatives from the administration and the secretariat has done a lot, including a survey or questionnaire. As you all know, we are very concerned about the remuneration and also reimbursement arrangements. We have been liaising with the government. The original intent is that within this term of office, we would like to get something done. But the government has been dragging things on, not just for Hong Kong, but also for LegCo. And until now, the only thing that we can do is to wait until the next term. So even if we want to take what we are given, we are not given anything. So we may have to wait until the next term. So we want to thank the secretariat for issuing the questionnaire. We have concluded your remarks. We have not invited the administration to come because we would like to go through a few things. The clerk has prepared a questionnaire, but it has not been returned by many of our members. Only 41 members have filled in the questionnaire. We have 70 members. So perhaps in a moment you can tell us what you think. We have never encountered this situation before. I've been the chairperson for many years. So when I'm gone, good luck to you all. We have received a letter from an assistant saying that some members have not filled in the questionnaire. There was no positive outcome. So the clerk has worked very hard. So I would like to thank Dora and her team for completing the questionnaire. So when we reach the next term, we will ask you the history. So Dora will first tell us what she's been able to do. We have issued the document to all the members. Actually, the results of the investigation is that you can see in part 2 and part 3, we have received 41 replies. 14 questions are contained in the survey, but not every member has responded to all the questions. So at different parts, we have quoted a number for replies for the questions, and then we further analyze the situation. I will focus on part 2. That is about the operational expenses of the office. If you refer to the report, page 2, para 6, I will first talk about staff expenses. In our survey, we asked members that for 2013-14, when they hire people, how much has been incurred and what is the wastage rate. According to the results, on average, per member, 9 full-time staff will be engaged and 2 part-time staff. Among all the full-timers, we can see half of them have a monthly income or salary between 10 and 15,000, and then another 20,000 between 15,000 and 20,000. For the educational attainment, 56% of these full-time staff have university degrees or above. But only 20% have working experience of more than 10 years. So concerning the working experience in members' office, 58% of such full-timers work for less than 3 years at members' office. Only 7% have worked for more than 10 years. So that is the situation. In the survey, we have also asked members how many staff members would be the best to help them discharge their duties as legislature members. We received 35 replies. Most members, about 30%, believe that there should be 10 full-timers. Another 30% believe that there should be 2 part-timers. As for educational attainment, about 26% of the responding members believe that among 10 full-timers, 7 of them should possess university education or above. But when it comes to working experience, the views are quite divided. Some ask for a few years, some ask for 10 years. As for remuneration, 44% of the members believe that in order to retain the staff, especially those with university education, the range of remuneration package should be between 13,000 and 15,000. Other than these remuneration, other cash benefits, including double pay, gratuity, medical benefits, and study allowance should also be offered. 36 members replied, and 35 of them believe that such cash benefits should be offered to retain the staff. We have also asked members, other than full-time staff with university education or above, they may also need other full-time staff or part-time staff. How much will be needed? So you can see the entire picture. We have calculated the amount of money needed per member. Among 33 replying members, about 20 of them believe that the correct level exceeds the level offered for 2013-14. So 20 of them need more in order to reach the optimal level. For such details, you can refer to the appendix 6 and 7. We have listed out the details of all the replies. This suggestion will only reflect the views of 20 members, and therefore, in the report, we have not made any concrete suggestions. We can see from a different angle concerning the remuneration offered to staff members, concerning the wastage level or turnover. For 2012-13, it was 21%, 2013-14, 16%, also very high. It shows that in terms of recruitment and retainment of talents, there are still some difficulties. We have set out the details in para 22-23. In para 21, you can see that among the 52 full-time staff who left, 62% received between 10 and 15,000, 20% received 15 to 20,000. And in subparagraph B, you can see the pay adjustment level. 12% of them received adjustment of 5 to 10%, 4% of the staff received adjustment of over 10%. More than half of these staff possessed university education or above. 23% had 1 to 5 years of working experience. 10% left within 1 year after working for the member's office. 54% left between 1 and 3 years. 8% left after 5 years. So the ratio is not that high. We've also asked them about why they left. 27% found better offers with better pay, and 17% found other jobs with better prospects. If you would like to refer to the details of these findings, you can refer to Appendix 9. Other than these two areas, we have also asked in the survey concerning the 9 recommendations not yet executed, are we to follow up on these points? Among 41 replies, all of them felt that we should continue to follow up with the 9 recommendations with the government. Perhaps I should go through them very quickly. The first 6 items are in relation to remuneration of members and their staff. Items 1 and 2 concern the composition of the staff members. Last time we talked about the fact that there should be grade 1 AO equivalent in every member's office. So at the headquarter office, there should be a staff at the level of AO1, and this person should should receive assistance from 2 clerical staff. So there should be 3 staff at the headquarter office. And for the regional or district offices, there should be 2 staff per office. One should be AO2 grade, and the other one also assistant clerical officer. Last time we felt that there should be 7 such staff in every member's office. Items 3 and 4 about the calculation of remuneration. For example, the median range of the remuneration, so on and so forth. And then item 5 is about gratuity, between 10 and 15% to enhance the level of their competitiveness. Item 6, also about salary. The annual adjustment should be based on civil service pay adjustments. All 41 members agreed, and then 3 existing recommendations. Last term, we saw someone suggesting that there should be accountable allowance for members to engage outside parties to undertake research work. Such work should also cover their own political party. Every year, we're talking about $239,000 for them to carry out such work. Item 8 concerning IT and communication equipment expenses reimbursement and setting up expenses reimbursement should be combined as one to be more flexible. And the level of allowance is about $500,000. For returning members, the number is 110,000 odd. We should increase it to 482,000 odd. So we will continue to follow up on this point with the administration. Finally, item 9. During the term of office, based on actual needs of the members, we could revise the operating expenses reimbursement level instead of waiting for the next term of office. It should take effect during a term.
We will continue to pursue this with the administration. For these 9 items, the 41 members all agree, and I think that's already over the 50% of the logical. So I think this wish should be included. And also, this questionnaire will also ask one more thing. That is about the long-term service payments and the severance pay. We already have been communicating with the government. The current arrangement is that we can only give this to the members when they resign. Then they use this winding up expenses, reimbursement to pay. But maybe some members already have been there for a long term, and then the staff might also continue to work there. But if the member is still in the term while the staff will leave, then we need to pay this staff long-term service pay. And now the government doesn't allow us to use the WUER, and then sometimes the members might have to bear these expenses from their own pocket. So we hope that we can use this WUER to pay for any of these long-term service payments and severance payments. And the government, if you don't want to change the function of WUER, you can also give us the allowance for this. For the 41 respondents, all of them believe that there should be the flexibility, and so we put it into the report. We will follow up with the government. And so that's the result of the second part of the report. And the third part is about the members' remuneration. There are two parts. And in the report, I already mentioned, because for the House Committee, and they have a lot of roles to play, so their salary would be higher. And also, because recently for the Finance Committee, we know that they are under huge workload and under stress and a lot of work pressure. So we want to ask if the chairman of the Finance Committee should also have the same level of salary. And about 17 from the 41 respondents agreed with this suggestion. Because this is not the majority, so we did not include it in the report. And then for the other members' remuneration. And so we asked the members, do they have any specific suggestions? From the answers we get, about 19 members didn't answer. So among the 16 replies, about half of them, sorry, I made a mistake. I should say 35 replies, well, about half of them, 16 of them, gave their opinions. That's the majority. And then 15 of them believe that the salary level should be increased. And I put it in paragraph 35. Although 15 of them believe the salary should be improved, but this 15 is not reaching the majority requirement, so we didn't include it into the report. So based on our research results, we have paragraph 38 and paragraph 39, and we hope the subcommittee to consider about the long-term service payment arrangement more flexibility. That's in paragraph 25, and also the government to reconsider about the 9 outstanding items. If our members agree with this, then we hope that the next step, we could invite House committees to note this report and agree to forward this report to the administration for consideration. Thank you, Dora. Okay, the floor is open. Mr. Lee, I want to know what happened, because last year you already gave that a suggestion for quite a long time. I also remember that time the government said they would consider, but 1 year later it seems that the government never talked about anything about it. So I want to say whether the government just want to cut one of our arms to have this kind of fighting, because we are here to supervise the government and government doesn't like it, then we would be like handicapped. And it sounds a bit tragic to say members are handicapped, but I say that the government want to tie our hands up and don't give us enough resources. You see, the turnover rate is really very serious. And also, most people are below 15,000 Hong Kong dollars per month. So with this kind of salary level, you see, you can only recruit those fresh graduates. Well, for those experienced people, it's difficult to retain them. So I say, members, we need to really accumulate these people and resources in order to be able to provide help to the government and also to be more familiar with the arguments and the issues. But with what the government is doing now, we don't have our think tank because people leave often and they don't have this experience. And then another problem is, can I ask Dora to answer your first question? What has the government done? Well, last time we submitted this report, that was in March 2011. And at that time, we actually did a very comprehensive report. And for the 9 outstanding items also were included in the previous report. Well, for the last report, the government already has reviewed the report and they have done what they can. Well, in the fifth term, they increase our operating expenses by 20%, and they see our what we lack, and they believe that level was adequate. That was the adjustment. And also, based on our previous reports, they also have changed something. For example, previously, we couldn't continue those outstanding allowance or the funding and move them on to the next term, but they agreed so the remaining funding can be moved over to the next term. That's more flexibility. And then second is the office expenses and the communications equipment expenses. Previously, it was 100,000 and 150,000 respectively. We asked them to combine the two together, and they agreed to combine them together so we can have more flexibility. Dora, please be as simple as possible. So last time, that was March 2011. That was previous term. They already read the report, and then 2012, after election, the new term, they also again talked to the government, and the government didn't reply. Did they reply to this? To be simple, because we actually in 2013 we held a meeting, and they believe that they already consider all we talk about in the report. So they agree for the 20% increase, and they said you all had your arguments in the report. If you have new arguments, then they could reconsider. So the report given by previous term, some of them were accepted, and then in the new term in 2012, this agreement already has been demonstrated in the new arrangement. And now we want to discuss again. They said last term we already gave you the arrangement, now you need to give me some new things, new arguments. But why we now only have this today, Dora? So because from the last report, for example, your turnover rate high, and you do not have adequate operating expenses, so they added 20%. That's already been done, but in 2013, they didn't agree to continue to give us more support, but they want us to have some new study and some new evidence. So Dora started this, but why from 2013 to 2015, why the survey continued for 2 years? Well, actually, we have this 2013 turnover rate, 21%. We already submitted this to the government for this turnover rate report. At the time, we asked for a meeting for the discussion, but they wanted more evidence. So later, we added some other supplement to material. But now they also are looking at our turnover rate to see whether they can do something. As far as I know, they are still thinking about it. Apart from the turnover rate, the secretariat, of course, recommended other survey. So for the survey, how long has it been continued? For this survey, 2 years. This survey has been done for 2 years. Why we want to have this 2 years survey? Why it lasts for so long? Well, actually, for this survey, it also included 2013 and 2014, but also it included the turnover rate from 2012 2013. Because in 2013, when we had the meeting, we said that we actually had this meeting in this term, and at the time, the term, the members were quite new. So we tried to wait for one more year to do the survey, because the assistants, indeed, at the time, the turnover rate of the assistants was very high. So we tried to wait for one more year and then to look at this turnover rate again. And then we submitted the result to the administration, and the administration asked for more information. They wanted to have clearer breakdown of the turnover rates. Well, of course, without the names of the members. Well, we submitted that. They have an independent commission to look at it. Now it's still underway. They haven't replied to us yet, because we already see that we actually have been running this for 2 full years. Well, our common practice is that before the end of the term, 1 year at least before the end of the term, we need to try to revise this remuneration level and then to get it ready for next term. So we need to do this, because then we can provide new suggestion to the government. So we actually gave up this term, right? The turnover rate, we already told them like 1 to 2 years ago in 2013, right? We started this in October 2013, because we need to have 1 full year's data. So we told them in 2014. So now 2015, now 1 year later, they still hasn't replied to our turnover problem that we submitted 2 years ago. So last term, turnover, this term continue to lose these people. I say government has double standard. Every time we talk to this committee about the civil servants' salary structure and internal structure, they always say that one thing is very important, that is your turnover rate and what is difficult to recruit people. Well, for us, our turnover rate is so serious. If we use the government standard, actually they would already increase the salary. So I say government now uses the double standards. They use their own standard, just focus on turnover rate and whether it's hard to recruit people. But for us, they don't use this same standard. So what is your suggestion? My suggestion is, first of all, for the two reports, A and B, of course, I agree. But I think the independent commission need to come to our committee, and we ask them not just to reply to A and B, because to reply to A and B, then they might just continue to leave it for future. You see, 2 years ago, we mentioned about turnover rate. They haven't replied to that yet. So we should ask them to reply to the report we submitted 2 years ago, the 21%. I believe that we could ask them to do that. But now we have this urgency, because now it's about the next term. If we still just use the same procedure for another 3 to 5 months, that would be too long. Well, of course, if you ask them to do this and that, we need to give them a kind of deadline. And also, I want to tell our members, we have about 72 members. We only have 41 replies. Then the government would say, not all of you replied to the questionnaire. So I say you need to be prepared. If they don't reduce your salary, you should be happy about that. That's for the next term. So now, even if we try our best to work on it, I don't know whether it is really workable, and then whether the next term can really have this, because they also have the independent commission, very complicated procedure. Why I said we need to mention about the previous turnover rate, because in theory, they should already have addressed this issue, but they haven't addressed this issue. And then, of course, we need to talk about today what we discussed. But my point is, in terms of the negotiation skill, you need to tell them about what they owed us. They owed a reply to our previous report about the turnover rate, and then also plus these recommendations.
Claudia Mo. Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm actually quite surprised that we have to wait until 1 year before the next term. Everything is in a blur, and you also talked about the deadline. I wanted to ask about the timetable. If this is for the House Committee for review, and then it is passed on to the government and nothing happens, and we come back in May next year for the same meeting, what does that mean? So, Lady Chair, do you think that the relationship between the executive arm and the LegCo is very poor? I trust that an independent panel will consider this topic, but is the government suggesting that LegCo continues to have filibustering? And perhaps that may lengthen the entire process. I cannot speculate what the government is thinking. You are not the worm inside the stomach, but this is the fact. It is not just about the relationship between the two arms. Even inside LegCo member, we only got 41 replies. 29 members are not interested in filling out the survey. No replies. What message is that for LegCo and the community, and also to the executive arm? So we can only produce what we can afford. We will hand this over to House Committee. But when so many members have not provided their replies, then maybe the entire thing will go down the drain before it reaches the government. The letters, if you refer to Appendix 3, on the 26th of March, it was sent to us from the Councillors Workers Association, saying that there's less than 10 replies. We urge members to pay attention to your interest and also your staff members' interest, so that please return the survey by 1st of April so that necessary information can be gathered and analyzed so that we can seek further benefits for our development. I'm sure these workers are watching the live broadcast of this meeting. So don't ask me what the administration is thinking. I wouldn't know. I cannot guess. They don't want to give us anything. Or if anyone suggests a deduction of the packages, they'll be very happy. Maybe 50% reduction, if you ask me to guess. But of course, that is not justified guess. Charlie, can you talk about the deadline or the timetable? When do we really need a clearer information? Dora? This is for the new term. The administration takes it very seriously. They kept asking for the information. And we have notified them that we have this meeting. So they are watching the live broadcast, and I'm sure they are laughing their heads off. But there are only two members here. So they do care about the timing. They have this independent panel. Once the House Committee passes this on, they will start working over the summer break. Previously, they have asked us to gather information about members' operations. They wanted to visit some district offices, and that was done last Friday. That is part of their work for this review exercise. So they have already started their work, and they're just waiting for the report. Anything else you would like to add? No? Speechless. In that case, the only thing we can do today is to express support for the report. Unless the final few points, without enough support, we need to remove those points. And then the report will be submitted to HouseCom this Friday and see what happens. If no one cares, someone can stand up and tear up the entire report. Chairman, you mean that we will just push over the tables? Well, I'm sure someone will die, or someone will fight fiercely, especially the affected workers. So with your approval, we'll leave it as that, Dora. The two paragraphs, just delete them, and then, well, make sure you attach this Councillors Workers Association letter. I would like to ask about the composition of this association. Who are these people? Dora, do you know? Have you done any investigation? They are real people. They are real people. Are they still working for the councillors? The turnover rate is so high. They just say something and then they leave. Should they all come down to the second floor? Well, I don't think that the association needs to do such thing. I'm not choosing the husband for my daughter. I don't need to meet with them. There should be a name list of the members of this association for us to consider. I have been working in Leshka for so many years. I've seen some people who casually form associations, so I would like to know who are the people in this association. Yes, we can contact them. We can't ask them to fill in their names, right? Do we have such a rule or practice? You have said something. So someone who is intimidating others, we have reason to believe that these are real people. Well, chairlady, I don't know why. Do you know who they are? Can you give any examples? They have attended our meetings before. Otherwise, they wouldn't know. Only 10 replies have been provided. I don't think any Leshka paper is confidential anyway. Well, my question is quite normal, right? I just want to know who these people are so that I can make a well-informed decision. Dora? Perhaps after the meeting I can contact the association because it sent the letter to 70 members and I got the copy. So I will see how many members they have, whether they are all assistants to councillors who provide the information to members. You know who you will contact? After we issued a survey, many people called us on how to fill in the forms. Some councillors didn't want to provide a reply, so we've been asked many questions. I'm talking about this letter. No one ever called me in the name of this association. So there is a contact number here. I've asked my staff. I have 3 workers, 3 assistants. 10 years and 9 months is the shortest working experience, the longest one. That's longer than your service. What is your term of service? This is my 3rd term, over 11 years. In other words, my assistant, the the one who has served for the shortest time, that person was engaged 3 months after I started. Can you share with us how nicely you treat that person? 8,000 when that person first started. What about now? If I remember correctly, 22,000. That's higher than ours, 15,000. I have 3 assistants. My expenses, well, are sufficient. It depends on how you use the money. So you didn't reply. No comments. I understand that things are difficult for you, but I will not apply my standards. If I fill in the details, it's not beneficial. Well, thank you very much for not making things worse. But I would like to understand, who are these people in the association? At least my 3 assistants are not members of this association. So what's the level of representativeness? Is it 1-man association? Or 2-men association? Or 2 women? So Mr. Wong would like to know who these people are in the association. Well, I don't want you to incite anyone. Is that how you chair a meeting? Are they going to march down to meet with me? Don't use the CCTV. I don't like that. Otherwise, I will leave. Well, don't leave. I'm just joking. To be honest. Is this how you invite them to meet with me? No, I invite them to meet with me. So the clerk is going to find out how representative this letter is. In the past, we have received this letter. In the past, no members ever questioned the level of representativeness. That doesn't mean I cannot ask now. I'm not saying you can't. Isn't that right? Is it legal and reasonable? It's definitely legal. I cannot say correct or wrong. I don't want to argue. So the clerk is going to take up this matter. Is it going to affect the report being submitted to HouseCom on Friday? That's totally separate. I just want to know how many people belong to this association. The level of representativeness. I want to know. And this is a reasonable request. So if you can find out, just attach information. We want to submit it to HouseCom on Friday. Before Friday, if you're able to obtain the information, you should attach to Appendix 3. Which assistants, to which counselors and their names. Hopefully, they will collaborate. They wrote this letter because they wanted us to pay attention to this matter. Any further questions? Well, any suggestion from the administration? Are you going to fight for us? Chairman, with your support, we will submit the report to HouseCom and we'll liaise with the administration. The independent panel is going to carry out some site visits to understand more about the operation of members' offices. I think that is beneficial to the whole matter. All right, thank you, Secretary General. So, Dora, please do this as soon as possible and hand it to HouseCom on Friday.